Okay, so good morning, everybody. Good early morning, actually. In this talk, I will review the status of the theoretical calculation for a luminosity measurement at E plus E minus machine. So this is the outline of my talk. So what I will do is actually review the status of the calculation for the E plus E minus machine, such as LEP and the flavor factories, so the past history, if you want, of this kind of calculation. So the radiative correction that are calculated and are implemented in the event generators in order to reach an accuracy which is at the level now of the one per mil. Then I will show you very briefly some recent advances, in particular the Tulu-Baba calculation which have been carried out in the last years, and then I will touch the issue of the vacuum polarization, which at this level can become a limiting factor for the precision measurement. Then I would like just to discuss very briefly a possible alternative for the luminosity monitoring, which is the E plus E minus to gamma gamma process, which has, at least from the theoretical side, some advantages. So, and then I will try to show how to improve the present situation in the Monte Carlo generators, and then we show you some examples before concluding. So there is no need, I explain too much this, why Baba scattering is important at any plus E minus machine for the luminosity monitoring. Let me just mention that at LEP it was chosen, the golden process for the luminosity monitoring was Baba scattering in the low angle, the small angle regime, so because it was a, so to say, a purely QAD process, so you could calculate very easily, very precisely the radiative corrections, while at the flavor factories it is used the Baba scattering at large angles. And also in this case it is also dominated by the T-channel exchange contribution. So in order to keep the error on the luminosity very small, the theoretical error has to be small, and so all the relevant relative correction must be included in the calculation and the predictions. So just to show you one example of why it is important to keep the luminosity under control, I just show you the neutrino counting measure experiment. So where from the LEP, this is from this report from the for experiment at LEP, we see that it has been measured very precisely, okay, but somehow the result is 2 sigma far from the standard model prediction, and a big part of this error comes from the luminosity determination. So half of this error comes from the luminosity determination, which in turn, the error on the luminosity is mainly due to theoretical uncertainties. So if we want to do precise measurement, we need to have to under control the luminosity, also the theoretical prediction, to very high accuracy. So before I start to review the theoretical calculation, let me just mention one point. So at high energy and high luminosity machines, it has to be taken into account also the effect of the beam Stralung. So actually the cross section, if you want, are the convolution over the beam Stralung spectra of the theoretical cross section. So if you want to know the theoretical cross section with high accuracy, we should know also the beam Stralung spectrum with a very high accuracy at the level of the aimed accuracy. Okay, so I will go now to describe how this cross-section is calculated. So, roughly speaking, the biggest part of the radiative correction to Baba scattering are due to QED corrections, which can be somehow, so to say, can be organized in terms of the collinear logarithm. Okay? So the correction, the form of the correction is reported in this table. So in this case, you resum all the collinear logarithms, and then if you go along the rows, you have the fixed order calculation. In a back of the envelope calculation, you can realize that the collinear logarithm at flavor factor is it's very similar to the at lap energies because you are in different angular regimes. And if you raise the energy up to FCC at the top threshold, you see that the collinear logarithm will increase of about 20%. So we expect that going from the Z to the top threshold, the QD correction will increase by 20%. Okay, so another point, an important point in my view is that the calculation should be implemented and available into Monte Carlo event generators, because this is the only way that you can take into account very complex event selection criteria due to the luminometry conditions. Okay, so this is what was done in the past. So a number of tools, Monte Carlo generators, were developed for the specifically for the luminometry. So these were the tools used at LEP. So BH-Lumi was the reference program, and then it was carefully cross-checked with the independent calculation. And also at the flavor factories, there are different tools which are used in the various experiments, okay? So, in order to achieve an accuracy which is at the level of one per mil, what you have to include in the event generators are, of course, the reading log QD correction up to all orders, and this can be done in different approaches, such as the QD parton shower, or the YFS approach, or the structure function. You need to add also the next leading order QED corrections, of course matched with the higher, with the multiple photon emission, if you want, with the leading log, with the tower of the leading logs. The relevant wing correction, this was done at LEP energies where these corrections are relevant. And then the vacuum polarization correction, I will comment a bit more later. And usually also part of the next leading order QD correction are somehow included. And then you should be able to generate fully exclusive events. So the situation now, at the moment, at least as far as Monte Carlo generators are concerned, is the following. So the error, the theoretical error, starts at the order alpha squared, because only part of the next leading order correction are included. And I think this can be, somehow this situation can be improved in a short time. So the next leading order correction, which are now available, can be included into the Monte Carlo. And then a big source of error, if you want, at this level, is the vacuum polarization parametrization. So the vacuum polarization, the hadronic contribution is, as an error, which is driven by the data, which can be a limiting factor. So the upcoming measurement at low energy machine in Novosibirsk and BESS and KEK will be essential in order to reduce the error due to the vacuum polarization. So I've stolen this slide from a talk by Jadak, where he reports, if you want, the error budget on the calculation on the Baba scattering at a small angle. So, and as you can see, I don't want to go too much into the details, but at the end of the day, the error is at the level of half per mil. So this quite impressive, I would say, accuracy was achieved by comparing different calculation, independent calculation, and try to give an error on the missing pieces of the calculations. So this was the situation at LEP. And also for the flavor factor is the view is similar if you want. We performed the estimate of the theoretical error on the BABA scattering cross section in a realistic situation for various flavor factories. And what you see is that the accuracy that we now have also at flavor factories is at the same level as at the lab times. Okay? So just to mention recent advances in this field, let me just say that in the last 10 years, a huge effort has been done in order to calculate exact to loop QED correction to the BABA scattering. These are very, I would say, impressive calculations. So the first one to be calculated were the two photon exchange contributions, then also the fermion loop correction. First of all, the electron loop correction were calculated. And then also the heavy fermion loops correction and hadronic loop correction have been calculated. And lately, also the one loop correction to the Bring-Stralung process has been made available. Okay, so all these calculations at the moment are not implemented into the Monte Carlo, but nevertheless, it was possible, at least at favor factories, to use this calculation to assess the accuracy of the Monte Carlo on a very solid ground. So here, for example, I show you a comparison of this kind of correction with the corresponding correction, approximate correction, which are implemented in one of the Monte Carlos, Baba Yaga, at low energy. And we performed a comparison in a realistic situation for luminometry, and what we saw is that the error, what we miss, is at the level of 2 × 10⁻⁴ to the minus 4. So these are a tiny correction, but quite important if you want to reach this accuracy. So another issue is the vacuum polarization correction. So the, of course, the running of the electromagnetic constant is an important correction. And as you know, part of the running of the coupling of the alpha QED is due to the hadronic part, which cannot be calculated from first principle, so you have to rely on dispersion relation, where the hadronic contribution is calculated using data for the E plus E minus two hadrons cross section. So since the data have error, also the hadronic contribution will have an error, and so the low energy data will be R and will be extremely important in order to reduce the error on the hadronic contribution to the vacuum polarization. And in the market, different compilation and routines.
Maybe we can ask you immediately, sorry if we start. You are discussing the contribution at MZ because it's through the Z part which enters, because the Q square is around zero at small
energy. Yes. So we show you
that's the reason. Okay.
Yes. But nevertheless, also at any Q squared, you use the data. So also in the bar, but
there would be no, just imagining, not real reality, but if there would be no Z exchange in the BABA scattering, the Q squared dominant part would be at zero.
Yes.
You never have Q squared MZ.
Yes, of course. Yes. But nevertheless, you have the minus T, so you have an error also on the T-channel exchange, okay? So I was saying that there are many routines, no, at least three routines that are available where they use the data to to give the hadronic contribution to the vacuum polarization. So just to give you some numbers, what I did, I ran our event generator at FCC energies just to see the various radiative correction, the impact of the various radiative corrections. So this is the impact of the Z exchange contribution, which is quite small at the level of some 10 to the minus 4. The next leading order QD correction are quite large, going from 17 to 20% as you go up with the energy. And also the higher order QD correction are quite important at the level of 0.5% of 1%. So they are important. So this is the effect of the vacuum polarization. And in the last line, there is the effect, in the last row, there is the effect of the error on the vacuum polarization. Okay, so this is at the level of a few 10 to the minus 4. So if you want to reach this accuracy, we should have a parametrization which is more precise. So if you want, I go back to the YADAC slide. So once you include into the Monte Carlos the next-to-next leading order corrections, all this error will drop, if you want, and what you are left is the error on the vacuum polarization.
You have a zero missing.
Yes, he has a zero missing. I grabbed just the slide. Okay. Yes, I just go quickly to this slide. So here, just to show you the effect on some distribution of the various radiative corrections. So this is the polar angle of the electron as obtained with the lowest order calculation, and with the next leading order in red, and with the higher order added in green. So as you can see, the next leading order correction are quite large, and also the higher order correction, for example, in the edge of the distribution, can be sizable at the level of 10 or 20%. This is another distribution which is more dramatically affected by the multiple photon emission. So this is the, if you want, the measure of the energy loss lost by radiation. And as you can see, the effect of the multiphoton emission is quite dramatic in the soft region, in the region of soft photon emissions, can be at the level of 60-70%. So this is something that has to be always taken into account. So before I conclude, just let me give you an idea. So also the E plus E minus to gamma gamma process could be used to cross-check, to have an independent cross-check of the luminosity measurement. So from the theoretical point of view, there are a few advantages. So there are noise Z exchange diagrams at lowest order. And moreover, there are no vacuum polarization correction, at least up to next-to-next leading order. So from the theoretical point of view, I think these are good points. Okay. From the downsides, if you want, is that it has a very lower cross-section, so it's a factor of 1,000 less than the BABA cross-section at small angles. And then I don't know from the experimental point of view if it's very clean to... It's not clean enough.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah. It's the same measurement requiring that there is no charge of particle.
Yes, okay. So yes, maybe it can be an important cross-check. So for example, if you want to measure some BABA-related quantities, so for example, the running of alpha in the space-like region, this could be used as a normalization, so you don't depend on the Baba normalization. Okay.
What is the theoretical error on the difference between the two cross sections in the same acceptance?
Theoretical error on the difference.
Well, between the two cross sections, because the difference will be the, dominated by delta alpha at this point.
Yes. But, well,
difference, if I understood correctly the talk, the difference would be dominated by delta alpha. Yeah.
Okay.
Because this is where you have zillions of events. Yeah, I mean, but what I do not know, what is the cross section of 4e plus and minus gamma gamma? Because it's
so I took the, here are the cross sections, okay? So, but these are picobands, okay? Okay, so it's more or less 1,000 less, a factor 1,000 less.
So you have to the dime. So you may have to say zero charge or not charge, but with an efficiency
better 1 per mil.
Yes.
Yeah.
It's cute.
Okay. Please conclude so we can.
So I'm just concluding just to say that the FCC can greatly benefit from the past experience on the calculation for the Baba cross section at LEP and flavor factories. So the tools to calculate the cross section at the level of with an accuracy at the level of 1 per mil are already on the market. And there is room also for improvements. So for example, because of the data of the low energy, and we can have a smaller error on the vacuum polarization, we can include systematically the next to leading order correction into the event generators. And also, of course, now there is the technology to calculate, of course, also exact order alpha weak corrections. And just a warning also that QED exponentiation is always needed in order to reach this accuracy. So, okay, I think.
Thank you very much. More questions? Yeah.
Excuse me. What is the reason for your last question, the beam shuttle?
Well, so because if I understand correctly, if I understand correctly, every cross section with the strong Beam-Strahlung has to be, if you want, convoluted with the Beam-Strahlung spectrum, right?
Yeah, but you have been working too much on the ILC.
Okay, yes. Because so this is not an issue for the.
The Beam-Strahlung, the main effect of Beam-Strahlung, and in fact we should do a little more work to make this statement more exact, but the main effect of Beam-Strahlung is to increase the energy spread. It does not distort the spectrum because if an electron stays in the machine, it will just oscillate on a synchrotron oscillation around the central energy. And so normally we don't expect to have a shift of the energy, only a widening of the energy spread. In that case, I don't think it makes so much of a big effect.
Okay, thanks.
I think your tail, you were discussing the tails more. Yeah. Okay,
so,
to check that.
Yes, so mine was just a warning that if you want to have a cross-section at the level of 10 to the minus 4, maybe right. Also this effect.
Yeah, I agree. I like your 2 gamma idea.
A question.
I have just a short remark to your Baba NNLO QD corrections presentation. You did not mention 5-point functions, yeah? I guess you are aware of the fact one needs them, and to calculate them is a thing which can be done. We made this for muon pair production, yeah? For yes. Muon factory and disinstalled. Maybe I don't want. We made this for muon pair production for Haram. And it took us 1 year to get two stable calculations which agreed, because the other one was unstable.
You go, the photon goes on top of the electron and it blows up, I guess.
I don't know what was the exact reason, yeah, because our calculation was stable. But I would like to mention that the new feature, so to say, hyperfine functions, yeah, they are well known as a source of theoretical work at the LHC, yeah?
Yes,
yeah. And people could think it's easy, yeah? But here you have to take into account the electron mass also. That is really a different topic and non-trivial. Okay.
Thanks for the remark.
Right, so we don't want the luminosity as just a number. I think what these machines need is the luminosity as a distribution, right? A beam energy spectrum. And that might give problems with the statistics that you have available to actually fix all those different points. And I can imagine there might be theory problems there. Could you comment on that? Some measurements are very dependent on the shape of the beam energy spectrum, top mass from the threshold, for instance.
I don't see any problem on the spot, at least. I have to think about it.
Okay.
Yeah, I see the point. It's less important than ALSC, because ALSC you have ET.
It's a very critical problem at the linear colliders. Yeah, but for us, as long as the electron stays in the machine, it'll just oscillate around the central energy. Otherwise, it just get lost. Yes. The measurement of energy spread is important for the Z-line shape. Yeah. But for this, probably less. I mean, we're talking about a change of 0.04% to 0.06% of the beam energy spread, something like that. So it's very small, especially at the low energy.
Last one, and then we continue.
I think it is motivated to look at how well you know the ratio between the gamma, E plus E minus to gamma gamma, and E plus E minus to E plus E minus. To try to understand what is its functional dependence and how well you know the terms. Because in the same acceptance. Because one could envisage an experiment where you measure the two terms. It's not a trivial one. But then if the residual dependence is on delta alpha, one can try to get access to this quantity.
Okay, fine. Let's thank the speaker again. So we move to the four fermion talks. Yeah.